Welcome and good morning. We're here again to worship together. You know, I never encourage my husband to blow his own trumpet, and I rarely do it for him. But the reason I'm here today is that Ian's been working all week on research to spearhead the production of Premier's broadcasting of Prince Philip's funeral. He didn't do it alone. Like all good productions, it was a team effort. But let's just say I'm proud of him. Today, anyway. And that's why I'm here. A friend's son writes for The Telegraph, and he wrote this yesterday. The Duke is a deep, devout, religious thinker who believed his funeral should glorify God rather than himself, insisting there be no eulogy or even a sermon. So I think that's what we are here for, isn't it? To glorify God. And in a week when restrictions are gradually easing and people can meet up with friends outside, we read about this meeting up of friends in Luke 24. And remember, they'd just had the Emmaus Road experience, so we're going to pick it up in verse 36. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It's I, myself. Touch me and see. A ghost doesn't have flesh and bones, as you see I have." When he'd said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they still didn't believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the Law of Moses, in the Prophets, and the Psalms." And so encountering friends is nothing new. Our first hymn of praise is "All Creatures of Our God and King," and we thank the Village Chapel Worship Band. Thanks.
right.
Living God, meet us here in the quietness as we make space from the world to speak to you and to hear you speak to us. Remind us of your greatness and your power, your grace and your mercy, your loving care. And as we draw near to you, draw near to us, enabling us through your power, encircling us in your love, enthusing us by your grace, enfolding us in your peace, as we come with joyful and thankful hearts. Amen. You will have heard this yesterday at Prince Philip's funeral, but it just so happens to be my dad's favourite hymn as well. And really, it's for everybody who's mourning any loss they've had during COVID. Eternal Father, strong to save. In 1984, Martin Nystrom, a Seattle school teacher, spent his summer at a Christian institute in Dallas. As well as wanting to draw closer to God, he also had his eye on a girl. Sadly, the girl didn't pan out, but he started fasting to get his relationship back on track with God. And he took the words of Psalm 42 and he penned, "As the deer pants for the water." And it was meant to be really his own personal meditation. But thankfully, he shared it, and it's a favourite sung in churches worldwide. And it just so happens to be a favourite of Joe Mainz, who's one of our church families. So illustrating the importance of connections, we'll sing it as a lead into our prayer time. And this week, our prayers are taken by our long-standing friend, Pat Kerridge. as the deer pants for the water.
As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you.
You alone.
You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you.
You're my friend, and you are my brother, even though you are a king.
You're my friend, and you are my brother, even though you are a king. I love you more than any other, so much more than any.
First verse in the chorus again, as the deer pants for the water.
Friends, as we come to prayer, let us remind ourselves of how Scripture encourages us to pray. Hebrews 10 verse 19 puts it this way: "And so, dear brothers and sisters, we can boldly enter heaven's most holy place because of the blood of Jesus. This is the new life-giving way that Christ has opened up for us through the sacred curtain, by means of his death for us. And since we have a great high priest who rules over God's people, let us go right into the presence of God with true hearts, fully trusting him." Loving Father, we come to you today with contrite hearts, knowing that we have failed you in every respect. We have done the things we should not have done and failed to do the things we should have done. We come asking for cleansing and renewing in the knowledge that you are compassionate towards us. Forgive us, Father, and fill us again with your Spirit. We are a fallen people in a fallen world, and we will bring that world before you now. In so many countries, people are struggling. We pray for China and Hong Kong, Pakistan, Iran, Syria and Myanmar, who under strict and powerful regimes, the people who own your name, are persecuted and ordinary human rights are ignored. Heavenly Father, we pray that leaders in these places may be touched by your Spirit and that change will come. Coming nearer home, Father, we pray for our own country. At this time of national mourning, after the death of Prince Philip, Duke of Edinburgh, we would lift our Queen and her family to you, remembering how your word tells us that you are the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in our troubles. As the nation mourns together, we bring to you problems arising in Ireland and pray for your Spirit to be at work, bringing wisdom and peace. And we pray for our government and the leaders in Ireland to have extra wisdom to bring peace and tranquility to that nation. During these difficult times, when everyone has been affected in some way by the pandemic and the measures taken to control the spread, many unforeseen problems have arisen. People are in danger of losing their jobs and their homes and are under great stress. Father, we bring before you those we know who are dealing with such circumstances. In your mercy, touch lives and bring peace. We thank you for one another, our church family, whom you've brought together. Thank you that though many of us have not been able to meet physically, we have, through the wonders of technology, been able to worship together and to keep contact with one another. We pray for those of our number who are struggling in mind or body, who have difficult decisions to make, who are looking to you for the next step. Forgive us when we ignore or choose not to heed your promptings and choose wrong directions. And we pray for our frontline workers, that you'll be with them and bless them, that they might be recovering their strength in these more relaxed days. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for all your good gifts to us, the beauty of the world around us, the love of family and friends, the joy of each new day, and your peace and presence at night. We ask these prayers in the name of Jesus, our Saviour. Amen.
You might be a convinced atheist, a committed Christian, or somewhere in between. Perhaps you've lots of questions to ask, or perhaps you're happier just sitting and listening. Maybe you go to church, or maybe you've never been. Whoever you are, Christianity Explored is a place for you to explore what life is all about. The Christianity Explored course is free, it's relaxed and informal, and it's run by ordinary people local to you. Some courses are held in churches with lots of people. Some are held in people's houses with just a few friends getting together. Wherever you meet, in each session, there's a chance to look at the life of Jesus for yourself and ask any questions you have. There's a short video to watch, and then a chance to chat about what you've just heard. You'll meet great people. You won't be asked to sing or pray or read out loud, and you don't need to know anything about the Bible to enjoy it. So whoever you are, come and explore. There's almost certainly a Christianity Explored course starting near you soon. So ask a Christian friend, or check out the website to find out more. You might just discover that the Christian message really is the best news you've ever heard.
Hi folks, Over the next few weeks, we're planning to start a Christianity Explored course. If you would like to join us, please contact us on the email at the bottom of the screen.
Our next hymn before we listen to Bob is You're the Word of God the Father.
Well, good morning everyone and welcome to worship. During Sunday school, the teacher asked her class if anyone could describe a Christian. A little boy quickly raised his hand and said, "Christians are nice people, folk who never complain or argue or talk back." He then added, "My daddy is a good Christian, but my mummy isn't." We decided last week that we need to understand that the only way to perpetuate truth and the freedom that Jesus brings is to pass it on by the way that we live and the way that we speak. Our children, they ground us because they see us and not the facade that we often present. And the facades that are really immature, well, they just carry on into our adult life. They make assumptions, follow crowd opinion, and react negatively rather than access the facts first. In our context this morning, the Apostle Paul, he'd said nothing. He was going about his business in the temple when he was accosted and restrained by those who were offended by what he stood for, basically because he was a follower of Jesus. I can vouch for how uncomfortable that is, having been badly treated for the same reason. All he had done was witness to the power of God and the liberty that he brings, challenging the man-made structures that demand control in God's name, and doing everything that was practically possible to meet the needs of others. He was in good company, of course, because this is the way of Jesus. You know, if folk had thought he was just a charity worker, they wouldn't have treated him so badly because he was looking out for the poor and needy. But the gospel he was offering is a life-changing reality, rather than just meeting some kind of short-term need. It demands an admission of guilt before a holy God and receiving forgiveness for that sin, so that whoever believes in Jesus will receive that same eternal life. Now his moment has come to explain himself to the people. Let's look together in Acts chapter 21, and beginning at verse 40. Standing on the barrack steps, Paul turned and held his arms up. A hush fell over the crowd as Paul began to speak, and he spoke in Hebrew. "My dear brothers and fathers, listen carefully to what I have to say before you jump to conclusions about me." When they heard him speaking in Hebrew, they grew even quieter. No one wanted to miss a word of this. He continued, "I'm a good Jew, born in Tarsus in the province of Cilicia, but educated here in Jerusalem under the exacting eye of Rabbi Gamaliel, thoroughly instructed in our religious traditions. And I've always been passionately on God's side, just as you are right now. I went after anyone connected with this way, went at them with all my might, ready to kill for God. I rounded up men and women right and left and had them thrown in prison. You can ask the chief priests or anyone on the high council to verify this. They all knew me well. Then I went off to our brothers in Damascus, armed with official documents, authorizing me to hunt down the followers of Jesus there, arrest them and bring them back to Jerusalem for sentencing. As I arrived on the outskirts of Damascus, it was about dawn. A blinding light blazed out of the skies and I fell to the ground and I was dazed. I heard a voice, 'Saul, Saul, why are you out to get me?' 'Who are you, master?' I asked. He said, 'I am Jesus the Nazarene, the one who you're hunting down.' My companions saw the light, but they didn't hear the conversation. Then I said, 'What do I do now, master?' He said, 'Get to your feet and enter Damascus. There you'll be told everything that's been set out for you to do.' And so we entered into Damascus, but nothing like the entrance I'd planned. I was blind as a bat and my companions had to lead me by the hand. And that's when I met Ananias, a man with a sterling reputation in observing our laws. The Jewish community in Damascus is unanimous on that score. He came, he put his arm on my shoulder. 'Look up,' he said. I looked and found myself looking right into his eyes. I could see again. Then he said, 'The God of our ancestors has handpicked you to be briefed on his plan of action. You've actually seen the righteous innocent and heard him speak. You are to be the key witness to everyone you meet of what you've seen and heard. So what are you waiting for? Get up and get yourself baptized. Scrub clean of those sins and personally acquainted with God.' Well, it happened, just as Ananias said. After I was back in Jerusalem, I'm praying one day in the temple, lost in the presence of God, I saw him. Saw God's righteous innocent and heard him say to me, 'Hurry up, get out of here as quickly as you can. None of the Jews in Jerusalem are going to accept what you say about me.' At first I objected. 'Who has better credentials? They all know how obsessed I was with hunting out those who believed in you, beating them up in the meeting places and throwing them in jail. And when your witness Stephen was murdered, I was right there holding the coats of the murderers and cheering them on. And now they see me totally converted. What better qualifications could I have?' But he said to me, 'Don't argue. Go. I'm sending you on a long journey to outsider non-Jews.'" The people in the crowd had listened attentively up to this point, but now they broke loose, shouting, "Kill him. He's an insect. Stomp on him." They shook their fists. They filled the air with curses. And that's when the captain intervened and ordered Paul taken into the barracks. By now, the captain was thoroughly exasperated. He decided to interrogate Paul under torture in order to get to the bottom of this, to find out what he'd done that had provoked this outraged violence. As they spread-eagled him with strips of leather, getting him ready for the whip, Paul said to the centurion standing there, "Is this legal, torturing a Roman citizen without trial?" When the centurion heard that, he went directly to the captain. "Do you realise what you've done? This man is a Roman citizen." The captain came back and took charge. "Is what I hear right? You're a Roman citizen?" Paul said, "I certainly am." The captain was impressed. I paid a huge sum for my citizenship. How much did it cost you? Nothing, said Paul. It cost me nothing. I was free from the day of my birth. That put a stop to the interrogation, and it put the fear of God into the captain. He'd put a Roman citizen in chains and come within a whisker of putting him under torture. The next day, determined to get to the root of the trouble and to know for sure what was behind the Jewish accusation, the captain released Paul and ordered a meeting of the high priests and the high council to see what they can make of it. Paul was led in and took his place before them. This had been a terrifying day. I wonder what sort of things Paul had been thinking about in the temple before he was set upon. And then those thoughts were suddenly replaced with the needs for survival. You know, it's great from our position of hindsight to see just how God intervened in an impossible situation to provide Paul a brilliant opportunity to tell his story to so many people, so that everyone would have the chance to think and not react like a bunch of sheep. I like the way he speaks with an honesty and with reason. He lays out his Jewish pedigree and they listen. And as he begins to change tack and speaking of his interaction with Jesus, he's trying to explain to them that he's not given up on Judaism, but he sees it as so much more than the tradition-bound edifice that it had become. This is an important point, you know, for us today, as many see the church as replacing Israel and Judaism. That simply isn't true. Jesus is the fulfillment of everything that God had promised throughout the Old Testament. So the church is Israel continuing. So those who receive the forgiveness bought by Jesus on the cross become heirs of God and co-heirs with Jesus. This means that the identity of God's people is caught up in the history and the promises made, so that we become and own it all as full family members. You know, later on, Paul wrote to the Galatians and he said, "Before the coming of this faith, we were held in custody under the law, locked up until the faith that was to come would be revealed. So the law was our guardian until Christ came, that we might be justified by faith. Now that this faith has come, we no longer are under a guardian. So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise." What a great challenge to us to drop our titles and our denominational names that claim our identity and start embracing the real life that Jesus has bought for us. You know, for the crowd listening to Paul, this was just too much. There'd been far too much water under the bridge, too much conflict. How, for example, could a Roman, a foreigner, an invader, how could a Greek with their strange ideas ever be changed and become heirs to the same promises that had been theirs for generations? You know, my mum once told me when I was being strict on our children, "The only way to keep your kids is to let them go." Well, this applies to truth as well. These folk in the book of Acts, like so many down through history, were holding on too tight to the things that they felt that they were in control of. For those Jews who had received Jesus, there was the claim that in order to be a Christian, one had to adopt the practice of Jewish exclusivity and identity in addition to faith in Jesus. In other words, our way or no way. When we can't get our own way, you know, our reaction, whether we show it or not, is always a negative one. Imagine for a moment a person dying and meeting Jesus in judgment. He's told, "Here's how it works. You need 100 points to get into heaven. You tell me all the good things you've done and I'll give you a certain number of points for each one." Well, that depends how good they are. When you reach 100 points, you get in. "Okay," said the man. "I was married to the same woman for 50 years and I never cheated on her, even in my heart." "That's wonderful," said Jesus. "That's worth 3 points. 3 points, he says. "Well, I attended church all my life and I supported its ministry. I gave my tithe and I gave my service. Terrific, said Jesus. That's certainly worth a point. One point, he said. I started a soup kitchen in my city and I worked in a shelter for homeless veterans. Fantastic. That's worth two more points, he says. 2 points, says the man. At this rate, the only way I can get into heaven is by the grace of God. Congratulations. That's exactly what you need. And this is so relevant to us, isn't it? Thinking that we must be able to merit some favour with God so that when we have to give an account for our lives, we might not be as bad as someone else. Not true. Wasn't it D.L. Moody who said, God sends no one away except those who are full of themselves? You see, to have confidence in ourselves, even traditions, it's not a bad thing. To be determined is not a bad thing. To have goals and ambitions is a vital ingredient for life, to have a full and meaningful life that is growing, and they prevent us from becoming stale and boring. But on their own, they have no real value at all, because our self-sufficiency just produces bubbles that we chase, bubbles that become an obsession until they burst. And what then? Another bubble? Another dream? So how about this? Forget your self-sufficiency. Stop holding on too tight and trust Jesus as your saviour. Every blessing.
Thank you, Bob, and thank you, Pat. And now our fellowship prayers. Let's pray together. Loving Lord, we come to thank you for all you've done for us this past week. And we look forward to what you will do in this coming week. We give you thanks for the many answered prayers. And we approach you again with the requests for those that we care about. So we thank you that Joe and Mary and Ben and Val are gradually improving health-wise. Be near to these two couples, Lord. We remember Joe Maines, who's had a couple of falls recently. Give him your confidence and your strength. We pray, Lord, for Mary Miller, who's getting her head round her eyes not being what they were, and we just pray that you be with Mary as she accepts and adjusts to her different situation. We remember Phil and Aileen's friends, Lord, Marie, who's seriously ill. We pray that you would bless her and the care that she's getting just now. And we pray that you draw close to Alice and Marie's husband as they stay by her side. We also remember Jackie and Alan, Bob, Joan and Carol's neighbour. Jackie's had a spell and back in hospital, but she's home now. And we pray that you would just strengthen her and bless her family at this sad time. We pray too, Lord, for Mick, Rachel's father-in-law, and we ask that you be close to him and his family as important decisions are made about the treatment that he needs. Finally, Lord, we bring before you, along with thousands of others, the Queen and the royal family. And we ask now that the official funeral's over, that you would be near to them as they grieve privately. And knowing the royal family, they'll be back to their work very soon, but we ask that you would just be close to them. And we thank you for the Christian witness that was yesterday. So thank you, Lord. You know our every need and you constantly supply it. So bless us all in Jesus' name. Amen. Our final hymn throws out that challenge to us as the Church of God on earth here. And it says, O Church, arise and put your armour on. Let's do that as we sing.
O Church, arise and put your armour on. Hear the call of Christ our Captain. For now the weak can say that they are strong. In the strength that God has given, with shield of faith and belt of truth, we'll stand against the devil's lies. An army bold His battle cry is love, reaching out to those in darkness. Our call to war, to love the captive soul, but to rage against the captor, and with the sword that makes the
And so, let's close in prayer. May we now go out into a new week, renewed in your faith, restored in your strength, redeemed in your love, and restored in your spirit, ready to serve you wherever that leads us. Now, we've met this 93-year-old lady before, but not for a while. She sings about our future hope, and I hope that you enjoy, but stay safe and stay well, When We All Get to Heaven, by Nita Tully.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, He'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory.
Shout the victory.
While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sign.
Prize before us, soon His beauty will be.
rejoicing.